Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Let's go to Colossians chapter 1. And we're going to continue with this, that we've been on this series, A Covenant of Blood. And we want to look specifically today at the blood of the resurrection. The blood of the resurrection. And we've looked at the blood of the cross and other aspects of the covenant. We want to look at the blood of the resurrection because the blood of the resurrection is the power behind the resurrection. And as we look at this, we're going to see the power of canceled sin. We're going to see the aspects of redemption that while known to us, we have to, you keep coming back to the principles of faith because they work. You keep coming back to the principles of the Word of God because they work. The number one thing that I can always remember as a man or a woman of God is to put my faith in the integrity of God's Word. The very first thing I learned to do was to put my faith in the integrity of God's Word, the completeness, the wholeness of God's Word. God cannot lie. Therefore, His Word cannot lie. It cannot. Isaiah says that His Word cannot return to Him void, but it will accomplish the thing that He sent it to do. Now, that is, again, in some of our circles, very simple. It can even be very elementary and even redundant. Well, yeah, you know, God can't lie. God will do just what He said. But here's the point. When I really come to believe that and it really becomes a reality in my life, then the power of the Word begins to be manifest in my life, in every area of my life, because God can't lie. The integrity of His Word is utmost in my thinking. This is what God said, and so because this is what God said, this is what's going to happen. And then you begin to answer every circumstance and every situation with that mindset. No, this is what God said, so this is what's happening. How do I know it's turning? Because God said it's turning. How do I know that it's going to occur? Because God said it was going to occur. Amen. And you keep coming back to that because that works. Amen. Now, Colossians chapter 1 and verse 20, notice what it says concerning Jesus. And having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself, by Him, I say, whether those things are in earth or things in heaven. The Woosh Bible says, having concluded peace through the blood of His cross. So Jesus made peace with God through the blood of His cross. That was, notice, making peace through the blood of His cross by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself. So, because of Adam's transgression, because of Adam's failure, because of Adam's sin, there was a wall, obviously, between God and man. Now, it was a wall that was of man's making. It was a wall that was of man's erection. Man had erected that wall. Man had built that wall. All right? God had nothing to do with that. God was never against man. Man turned against God. Man disobeyed God. Now, that's why the sacrifice of Jesus is as much about willingness as it is obedience. All right? Because he was obedient, but he had to be willingly obedient. And he had to be obediently willing. See, what hampers a lot of people from receiving everything that they need from God is they'll say, well, I'm obedient, but they weren't willingly obedient. I remember hearing testimonies as a boy growing up, somebody would say, well, you know, I was sitting in that meeting, they were receiving this offering, and I was raised Pentecostal, and I'm very blessed by that. I don't like to use the word proud, but, you know, I'm not ashamed of my heritage. I'm saved today, praise God. So, but here's the point. There would be this testimony, you know, about giving, and how they sat in the back and they were receiving the offering, and the Lord said, I want you to give that $50 in your pocket. And I argued with the Lord. You knew when they started telling that story, there's going to be an argument somewhere. I argued with the Lord. I told the Lord, Lord, now I got plans for that $50. Amen. And here a little bit later, the Lord said, you know, I want you to give that $50 or whatever the number was. And of course, he said, you know, I argued. And, you know, I had a $100 bill and God wanted me to give 50. And I argued with God for 15 minutes. Seemed like the longest offering ever. He said, finally, I relented and I said, okay, God, I'll go and I'll give. And he and then the story was inevitably, and then God said, no, now I want the whole 100. Well, I always thought, well, dummy, the moral of that story is give the 50. Right? I mean, that, right? Doesn't that make sense? Well, see, what they were saying without understanding what they were saying was they weren't willingly obedient. If God's got to, so to speak, twist your arm, then you're kind of being made to do something. God doesn't make anybody do anything. He'll keep dealing with you. Amen. Do you understand that? Until either you do it or it becomes very clear that you're not going to do it. And then what happens is then God just moves on to find somebody that will be willing. And then people will say, well, bad things happen, so God got upset. No, God didn't get upset. Your obedience would have placed you in a place of protection and blessing. But when you persist in disobedience, it opens the door. It's not God. Listen, am I helping you with this? When Dr. Lester Summerall was 16 years of age, he was laying on his deathbed. All right, he had been afflicted with tuberculosis, and back in those days, that was a death sentence. And I mean, he was coughing up pieces of his lung on the pillow where he lay. The doctor came to his house and signed his death certificate. He said, I'm going to sign his death certificate. I got to go visit with another patient. He said, by the time I get back, he'll be dead. So he went ahead and signed the death certificate. Well, he saw a vision, and he saw on the right side of his bed, he saw a coffin. On the left side of his bed, he saw a Bible, both of them big. And God said, I'm giving you a choice today. He said, you can rise up off this bed and go do what I'm asking you to do, what I've called you to do, or you can lay here and refuse, and that's the other option. Now, God didn't say, I'm going to kill you. He said, this is what's going to happen. You can get over here, and God, that was mercy. Now, Dr. Summerall said through the years in his ministry, he said, it's real easy for me to keep doing what God wants me to do because I know the option. One man met with Dr. Oral Roberts one time, traveled a long distance and met with him and set up a meeting with him. And when he got in the meeting with him, he said, Dr. Roberts, I have come a long way to discuss something with you. And he said, what do you want to discuss with me? And he said, I came here to tell you how I don't believe that healing is the will of God. Dr. Roberts stood up and said, our meeting is over. The man said, no. Wait a minute. Why is our meeting over? He said, because for me to sit here and hear you talk about how the will of God is not healing is to accept back my stammering lips and the tuberculosis of my lungs, and I will not do that. Because if you know Dr. Oral Roberts' story, he was smitten with tuberculosis at 18 years of age, playing basketball for his high school. He was a great athlete, fell out on the floor, went home, and they put him in bed. He's going to die. He doesn't have any hope. But his sister heard of a Holy Ghost tent meeting, and she came and said, we need to load him up and take him to the tent meeting. On the way to the tent meeting, the Lord told him, he said, I'm going to heal you and I'm going to raise you up. You're going to take my healing power to your generation. Amen. And sure enough, they took him in that tent and God healed him and raised him up. And he took God's healing power to his generation. But understand, notice what they decided to be. Obedient and willingly obedient. So Adam was willfully disobedient. So that meant there had to be one that was willfully obedient. It had to be matched completely. Jesus could not be made to come to earth. God didn't have to make him. God didn't come to him and say, look, I made a drastic miscalculation where Adam was concerned, and I need you to help me clean up my mess. But very often, isn't that how it's taught? Isn't that how people lead us to believe? That God looked when Adam fell and went, whew, dang, missed that one. No, he never did that. He knew that was going to happen. Before the foundation of the world, he made a covenant with the Lamb and with the Holy Spirit, because he knew what was going to happen. God's never been behind the devil. He's not behind the devil now. He's not late. He knows what's going on. So Jesus had to be willfully obedient as much as Adam was willfully disobedient. And notice what happened. He made peace with God through the blood of his cross. God was not angry at man, but there was a rift between God and man from man's part. Man had deserted God. God had not deserted man. But because of man's transgression, God could not get back to man without blood. And it had to be the blood of a willfully obedient sacrifice. Had to be the blood of a willfully obedient, perfect, spotless, sinless sacrifice. Aren't you glad Jesus qualified? Amen. Now look at Hebrews 9:22. Now if you're in Bible school here, especially first year, where's all my juniors at? First year juniors. Hallelujah. I believe y'all might be the best class ever. I don't know. Hallelujah. We'll see. I don't know. I love you, Pastor. I love you too. Now all my seniors say, what about us? Well, listen. That's my wife's class, the juniors. Happy wife, happy life. Amen. Hallelujah. No. They're both real good classes. But if you're in the junior class, you know this has been our foundation teaching for the blood covenant. And notice what it says. It says, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission. And remember that word remission means to put away, to nullify, to disallow. All right? Without the shedding of blood, there's no remittance. That sin cannot be remitted. It cannot be put away. It cannot be nullified. It cannot be made as nothing. All right? I need you to understand something. When you got born again, you know, your sins weren't covered. Your sins weren't just covered up. They were remitted. And we'll get more into that in a minute. They were remitted. They were moved away. They were taken out of the way. They don't exist. Because that was the blood of the Redeemer. The blood of a bull or a goat could only cover. It could only put an X over that sin for the year coming up. But the blood of Jesus Christ, the Bible says, washes. See, when they came out of Egypt in Exodus, do you remember there were two components that God said? Very often we just mention the blood, but there was another component that God said needed to be mixed with the blood when they came out of Egypt. Hyssop, H-Y-S-S-O-P. He said to mix the hyssop and the blood and put it on the doorpost. Well, why? Hyssop was a cleansing agent. Now listen to the importance of this. That blood in Exodus was a type and shadow of the blood of the Redeemer. The blood of the Redeemer didn't just cover sin, it cleansed sin. There was an element of that Redeemer blood that wasn't in any other blood. And it was the ability to wash that sin away. Not just wash it and you could faintly see the outline of it. Wash it away as if it never existed ever. Amen. That is remittance. Am I helping you? In Matthew chapter 26... verse 28, glory to God. Look at your neighbor and say, I perceive that you are clean by the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Isn't it good? Hallelujah. That old account was settled long ago. Amen. Matthew 26, verse 28. This is my blood in the New Testament, which is shed for many. For what? Remission of sins. Whenever you see the word remission, translate it remit. To put away, to cancel, to nullify, to take out of the way. Hallelujah. He said that his blood was shed to remit sin. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible says that people that call and count the blood of Jesus as an accursed thing, it says there's no hope for them. Why? That's the only hope they have. Somebody that won't accept the blood has no hope, because there's no hope of being cleansed any other way. Amen. Now, Matthew 27. And verse 50. Glory to God. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And notice, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks were rent. Now, the veil of the temple was torn in half. Now, understand that we know that it was torn from the top to the bottom. And people say, well, that signifies that God did it. Well, of course God did it. If it was done, God did it. But notice that it was torn in half. When Jesus said in John 19, verse 30, he said he cried out, when he cried out with a loud voice, it is finished. It is finished. Well, what did he mean, it was finished? What did he mean when he said that? Because redemption was not finished until after he came out of the grave. Until after he went to the belly of the earth. Until after he went to the Holy of Holies and placed his blood on the altar. So when he said, it is finished, what's he saying? He's saying the old covenant is finished. Now, it's a wonderful Greek word. It's the Greek word tetelestai. Tetelestai comes from two Greek words that come together. Tetelestai. And it literally carries the idea of a servant or a slave being sent on a job. And he goes and he completes the job. And then he comes back to the boss. He comes back to his employer. And he would come up to the employer and he would say, tetelestai. It's complete. I've done what you ask. Well, now listen. He was redeeming mankind from their sin, but Jesus also had to fulfill the old covenant. Without the old covenant practices and the old covenant ordinances being completed, there could be no redemption. He had to perfectly fulfill the law. So he's saying here, the old covenant, the Old Testament is finished. Now, that doesn't mean done away with. It means fulfilled. Jesus Christ himself said, I did not come to do away with the law. I came to fulfill the law. Amen. See, there, you got to understand something. God never took the law out of the way. God's law is still God's law. What has changed is man's ability to keep it. Oh boy, it got quiet. Because see, in the day and age we live in, oh, God's not a God of laws. God is a God of love. That's impossible. I said, that's impossible. What is written is written. Listen, if a person's not born again, are they under law or under grace? What are they going to be judged by? Law, right? Why? They never accepted Jesus, who did what? Fulfilled the law. So they'll stand before God and be judged by the law, by the perfectness of the law. But you and I will stand before God and be judged by the perfection with which Jesus kept the law. Amen. Do you understand that? So what has changed is you and I's ability to live out the ordinances of God. I can love you with God's love, and Romans chapter 13 says that is the keeping of the law when I can love my neighbor as myself. Amen. Why? Because if I love you, I won't lie to you. If I love you, I won't cheat you. If I love you, I won't murder you. If I love you, I won't hate you. Come on, are you with me? So when he said, it is finished, okay, I fulfilled the old covenant. I fulfilled the Old Testament. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go into the belly of the earth, and I'm going to pay the complete penalty for their sin. And then I'm going to rise on the third day over death triumphant. And I'm going to take my blood to the Holy of Holies, and I'm going to put it on the mercy seat in the heavenly places. And then everybody that puts their faith in me will have access to God through my blood. Amen. Amen. And that's why it don't matter how perfect or imperfect you've been. Some of y'all have been very imperfect. Amen. I am chief among you. Amen. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you've done. See, religion has been, they've waffled on us. Because they'll preach from the pulpit, it doesn't matter what you've done. God will save you. God will redeem you. God will set you free. Amen. But then right on the other hand, all these other things, that if you miss the mark even a little bit, they put that condemnation and guilt on you, and I thought you were saved. And you know, here's the issue. The easiest thing to do is to point your finger at somebody who's doing the exact same thing that you used to do, the exact same thing that you used to want mercy and grace and forgiveness for. Remember what the Bible says. The person you show mercy to is the person you'll get mercy from. The blood of Jesus saved everybody that's saved. The blood of Jesus cleansed everybody that's cleansed. The blood of Jesus redeemed you where he found you. He didn't wait on you to get things right. He redeemed you so you could be right. He did not wait on you to get everything in line. He redeemed you so you had a shot at getting everything in line. Glory to God. Aren't you glad? Amen. No perfect people, but a perfect Savior. No perfect people, but a perfect law keeper, a perfect Savior, a perfect sacrifice. And the perfect sacrifice makes up for the imperfect sinner. And the perfect Redeemer makes up for the imperfect person that was in slave to sin. I'm here to tell you today, it doesn't matter what you've done. It doesn't matter where you failed. The blood of Jesus is greater than that. It is stronger than that. It will cleanse it and wash it away. And here's the thing, with no strings attached. Amen. So God's law has not went away, because that's what he will judge sinners by. But you and I have already been judged. And we've been judged righteous. We've been judged holy. Now, that doesn't mean you can go live however you want and do things that are sinful. Saved folk don't do that. Am I making sense? If you're saved, there's certain places we don't go. Don't drink, smoke, cuss, or chew. That's what they said when I was growing up. Or hang out with them that do. Amen. You say, but I chew. Well, it's all right. We're praying for you. Just don't spit in here. We don't have ashtrays or spittoons. Glory to God. Aren't you glad? There's a veil between the holy place and the most holy place. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 6 inches thick. I mean, it was a massive veil. And God had them. And you got to understand something. The glory of God could penetrate that veil very easily, but God, obviously holding the himself back, did not. But that was an indication to, hey, this is weighty. This veil is 6 inches thick. This is weighty. Now, understand, it was torn from top to bottom. That's like trying to tear 3 phone books apart. No way a man could do it. You know what God's showing us? There's no way by your empty, vain effort that you could ever reach me. You couldn't do it because there's too much in between you and I. That veil ultimately represented the barrier between us and God. And there was nothing that we could do. And until there came a Redeemer, there was nothing that God could do. But understand this. From the day Adam sinned, God already had a plan in order. He already had a plan in place. And all the pieces just started falling into place. And God showed on that redemption day, he tore the veil from top to bottom. He said, there's nothing you could do to open the way to get to me. But there was one, and he just died on the cross of Calvary, that did have the ability to keep my law and walk perfectly before me. And he did it, and because he did it, I'm personally going to open the way myself. Why? Because God wanted relationship with us. Oh, glory. See, there was a holy place and a most holy place. Even the priest could only enter into the most holy place once a year. And then not without blood. The Levites could go up to the holy place. They could never enter the most holy place. The nominal Israelite could not go any farther than the courtyard. They could get their sins remitted and that was it, or atoned for and that was it. This is so powerful, because after the brazen altar where those sins were paid for a year, there was another piece of furniture called the laver. It was the washing station. It was where the priests that ministered unto God would wash off the filth and the grime and the blood from offering all those sacrifices. The nominal believer, if we can use that term, in those days could not go any further than that burnt altar. They could not go any further than that brazen altar. Brass representing judgment. The judgment of God would fall on that sacrifice, and they would be considered atoned for. Notice, not cleansed, not remitted, just atoned for. Amen. But in under the new covenant, you and I not only came to the altar of judgment and received Jesus as our sacrifice, we went to the next step and we were cleansed from our sin in the water of the Word of God and the blood of the Son of God. And then we were able to go into the holy place and partake of the light, partake of the Spirit, the candlestick, the Holy Ghost. We were able to partake of the bread of life, which is the table of shewbread. Amen. We were able to have communion with God, which was the altar of incense. But then even beyond that, we were able to go into the holy place, the most holy place, and have fellowship with God. But then here's what happened when you got born again and say, the most holy place came inside you. I am the dwelling place of the living God. And his blood made that possible. So you're not just an old sinner saved by grace. You're not just bumbling, stumbling along. You're not just a pilgrim on a journey, wading through the rain and the cold. You're not just looking for a city where we'll never die. You're never going to die, and you're never going to die here. You're never going to die ever. You're not looking for that city where you're never going to die. You're going to move one day to that city, but you're not going to die to get there. Why? You never are ever, 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 ever going to die. This body will fall over with a thud. It will go back to the earth, but you, my friend, will never die. Hallelujah. Why? Jesus said, the kingdom of God is within you. Isn't that beautiful? And the blood of Jesus made that possible. Oh, glory. Whew. Look at Ephesians chapter 2. I'm ahead of myself and getting there fast. Hallelujah. See, I tell the students all the time, this changed my life. Understanding that I had a covenant of blood with God changed my life. It totally changed everything about what I believe. Amen. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 15. Well, glory. God bless you. Verse 15. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity or the enemy, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain, notice, in himself of twain. Now, understand what that means, of two different parts. Remember, the Bible says that the seed of Abraham is not two different seeds, it's one seed, two different aspects of the seed. There's the natural seed and the spiritual seed. The spiritual seed has not replaced the natural seed. The natural seed is not better than the spiritual seed. But there's two. And it says that in Jesus of twain, one new man, so making peace, that he might reconcile both unto God in one body, Jew and Gentile in one body, by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Now notice something. He says that the enemy was ordinances and commandments that were contained against us. Hallelujah. What was the enemy? The ordinances and the commandments. Say it with me. The ordinances and the commandments. Now, understand why they were enemies. You couldn't keep them. It was an enemy because you couldn't keep them. Now, I know that sounds simple, and it is simple. But that's why it was an enemy. The law was not an enemy because it was bad. Matter of fact, James and Paul both said that the law was good and perfect and just. The law perfectly did what it was supposed to do. How do I know that? Because if you're in here and you're born again, the law helped you get saved. Because one day you figured out, I'm a sinner. You heard somebody say, you shall not commit adultery. And you might have had to ask somebody, what does it mean? But once you found out, maybe you went, oh, that's me. And you knew, I'm sinning. I can't be doing that. Well, what helped you see that? The law. But why was it an enemy? You couldn't keep it. You kept butting up against it. Paul said, by the law is the knowledge of sin. Amen. But where no law is, nothing can be held against you. Now that doesn't mean there's no law. It means we're free from the law because Jesus kept the law. See, and people say, oh, so you mean we don't have to keep the law? No, it means that you are spiritual and you keep the law without a lot of effort and even trying to, because you're made in the image of Christ, who was perfectly pleasing to the Father. And right here, he made of two different people, Jews and Gentiles, one new man. How? In his body on the cross. Hallelujah. Am I helping you? Jesus, by the blood of the cross, broke down the middle wall of partition. That was that veil. The veil signified that middle wall of partition. Hallelujah. Now, let's go over here to Hebrews 10. I've had people wonder, why do you use so much scripture? Because we come to church to hear what the Bible says. Amen. Amen? That's why it is Bible study. Glory to God. Hebrews 10, verse 19. Notice. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and a living way, which he's consecrated for us through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. Hallelujah. Under the new covenant, we can have boldness. That word boldness means confidence. There is a confidence in us under the new covenant. To do what? We have boldness, we have confidence. No shame. Say out loud, no shame.
No shame.
Say out loud, no guilt.
No guilt.
Come on, no fear.
No fear.
Say none.
None.
Hallelujah. You may say, Pastor, I'm still dealing with that. Okay, but I'm helping you today. I'm setting you free.
Amen.
There's no shame, no guilt, no fear. No shame, no guilt, no fear. Say it again. No shame, no guilt,
no fear.
See, that is foreign to the believer. Amen. Now, that's what the enemy works in. Hallelujah. He brings up what you did 5 years ago, 5 minutes ago, 5 days ago, right? And he always attaches shame, guilt, fear with it. Ashamed of what you did, guilty about what you did. Ashamed, afraid that people are going to know what you did. Well, we know. Even though we may not know what you did, we know you did something. You did something. Amen? Everybody but Rusty has done something. Right? It may have been big or it may have been what we say small, but understand something. I'm helping you with this. There's no big or small. God does not grade failure and sin on a curve. The blood of Jesus made everything equal. There's no big or small. It doesn't matter what you did, where you failed, how you missed it, how big you think it was, how small you think it was. I have confidence, no shame, no guilt, no fear to do what? Enter into the presence of God. Amen. He says, I enter in by a new and a living way. I enter in through his body. Through him, through Jesus, through his blood. Now, in Hebrews 9, and look at verse 7. But into the second, or the holiest of holies, went the high priest alone once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and the sins of the people. Hallelujah. Now, look at verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Jesus, the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. So the high priest could not go into the holiest of holies without blood. Now there's a reason for that. If he went without blood, there was nothing to atone for the sins of the people. He can't do it. They can't do it. There has to be the blood of an innocent sacrifice. Remember, we taught in the very first part of this series, the life, Leviticus says, the life is in the blood. Amen. The life is in the blood. So that animal was innocent, and that animal gave its blood, and the priest could take that blood in and atone for the sins of the people. Hallelujah. The blood of the resurrection, the blood that was offered on the Holy of Holies, was required to make eternal redemption. For there to be eternal redemption, there had to be blood in the holy place in heaven. It was required. It wasn't something God thought would be nice. It was a requirement. It had to be done. In Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, The Apostle Paul talks about the resurrection. And he says concerning it, concerning himself, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Well, we already know him in the fellowship of his suffering because we're living in the flesh. Jesus' suffering was not the cross, it was living as a man. The suffering on the cross was part of his suffering, it was not all of his suffering. Amen. The sufferings of Christ that I enter into are not the things that he freed me from. You understand that? People have thought for years, to enter into his sufferings. Well, you've already done it. You're born again and you're living life in the flesh. So you've already entered into his sufferings. Nowhere in the Bible does it say you need to suffer like Jesus suffered as he suffered on the cross. That would be redundant. Amen. Do you see what I'm saying? That doesn't make sense. That's like wearing a t-shirt under a t-shirt. What's the point? Amen. Well, wearing socks with sandals. What is the deal? Now, if you do that, I'm not mad at you, but I mean, what's the deal? Aren't sandals so you don't have to wear socks? I thought. I don't know where I was. Y'all lost me. The blood was required for eternal redemption. So he doesn't want me to suffer what he suffered. He suffered for me so I wouldn't have to suffer. His suffering that I enter into is living this life in the flesh, overcoming temptation, overcoming the enemy. That was Jesus' suffering. The cross was a part of his suffering. That was his job, not my job. Well, Jesus said we all have a cross to bear. Right. We all have something that we're supposed to do. That's our cross. But our cross does not involve being nailed or thorns in the head or whip on the back. Are you following me? Now, we will experience in the future the power of the resurrection. When we, if we die, we'll be resurrected when Jesus returns for the church in the rapture. Amen. But we also experience the power of the resurrection right now. I've got a series on that called The Power of the Resurrection. Resurrection includes being raised from the dead. But listen, it also included being resurrected from the dead and eternal redemption. That's the power of the resurrection. The resurrection meant Satan was defeated. And men were freed from sin's dominion. Hallelujah. See, it's one thing to have my sins remitted. It's another thing to know about it. It's one thing to have your sins remitted. It's another thing to live in dominion over sin. Hallelujah. In Colossians chapter 2, we looked at this over the offering. Verse 14, notice what he says. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. So he nailed the ordinances that was against us to his cross. The ordinances was sin. The ordinances were those things that was against us. The ordinance was contrary to us. You got to understand, it was never God's will that you be labeled a sinner. It was never God's will that we be sinners. That was against us. It was never God's will. So, He took it away, nailed it to his cross. Hallelujah. When he uses that word handwriting, handwriting is a written agreement acknowledging a debt. That's what it means in the Greek. A written agreement acknowledging a debt. And it was this debt that Jesus wiped out for us. Literally, it means, when it says blotting out, it means to wipe out. See, in these days, when Paul would have written this, the ink that they used to write on the papyrus paper, it didn't have a lot of acid in it. So when you write with a pen, what makes it stay on the paper is the acid that's in the ink. It bites into the paper, right? That's why you can erase something written with a pencil. They even have erasable ink. It's lacking in acid. You can erase it because it doesn't bite into the paper. So when they were teaching young Greek students to write and teaching them to the alphabet and teaching them how to spell, they would use this ink. It didn't have a lot of acid in it, and they would write on that papyrus paper. And then the instructor would come along with a wet sponge, and he would just wipe the record of it out of the way. If they misspelled the letter, he would just take the sponge and wipe the record of it away. There was no record of it left. Their handwriting was wiped away. So before you got born again, there was a handwriting of ordinances that was against you. Every sin you had ever committed, every failure you had ever made, every mistake you had ever committed. But here's the thing. There was no acid in that handwriting to keep it on the paper. And when Jesus died, he dipped that sponge in his blood and wiped it all away. It doesn't exist anymore. Hallelujah. Isn't that good news? Hallelujah. Romans 6:14 says, sin shall not have dominion over you, because you're not under law, you're under grace. Now there's a couple of things to look at. Why is that the case? Why does it matter? People will quote that, and I'm not even sure that they understand why that's the case. The law was weak where sin was concerned, and here's why. It can define sin, but it cannot cure it. The law can tell you what sin is, but offer you no answer. Hallelujah. Have you ever had somebody tell you the problem, then you say, well, what do I do about it? I don't know. Amen. Somebody hears your brakes squeak and says, that's your brakes. Well, how do we fix it? I don't know. Then be quiet. Isn't that what you want to say? Why'd you tell me then? You can't fix it. So the law could define sin, but it cannot cure it. The blood of the resurrection wiped out sin and fulfilled the law. Hallelujah. I have a series called Everything is Different, but Nothing's Changed. Sin is still the problem and Jesus is still the answer. Because it wipes out sin. Amen. Do you see that? So why can't sin have dominion over us? Because of the blood of the resurrection. Now, I want you to really focus in on that today. This is what the Holy Spirit's really dealing with me about. Sin cannot have dominion over you if I don't give it dominion over me. That great theologian, Flip Wilson, was wrong. The devil did not make you do it. He gave you the thought. He gave you the opportunity, but he did not make us. Say it with me. Sin has no dominion over me because of the blood of the cross. Hallelujah. So the blood of the resurrection eternally defeated Satan, and the price for sin remitted your sin nature. remitted it, moved it out of the way, canceled it, nullified it. Amen. That's why people will get saved and they'll say, you know what? I don't even want to do that anymore. Your nature's been changed. If we wouldn't tell people what a battle they're supposed to have with their flesh, they wouldn't have such a battle. But people get saved and immediately, you know, you got people, well, now I know it's good right now. And I know you have that euphoria of being saved, but let me, come here. You better just get ready. Because the old devil's a-coming. Why don't we tell them the enemy's going to show up and you have a weapon right here in your belt and you just take that weapon out and cut him long, lean, and often. Not he has no power over us. Am I helping you? So sin shall not have dominion over you because you're not under law, you're under grace. Amen. Because of the blood of the resurrection, hear me, God holds nothing against the human race anymore. There's nothing between any man and God anymore. God has already satisfied the wrath he had towards sin. He's already satisfied it. It came to completion in Jesus. So anybody that suffers the wrath of their sinful life will do so because they rejected the blood of Jesus. Not because God's angry. God is just. God is the perfect just judge of the entire earth. Do you understand that? And when someone stands before God and they've not received Jesus as their personal Savior, God has no other option than to keep the letter of the law. Because he can't change. He didn't change when he saved you on the basis of you receiving Jesus. He prophesied that from the fall in the garden. That there was coming one that was going to redeem mankind. Buy them back from the slavery of sin. Buy them back from the devil that had been holding them hostage. It's the Greek word lutroo, L-U-T-R-O-O. It means ransom paid to the highest possible amount. God bought us back from the enemy. Therefore, because he had a man, number one, in Abraham that would believe him and get his covenant into the earth, then he said, somebody out of your lineage, Abraham, is going to bless the entire earth, the entirety of humanity. And that was Jesus Christ. And the Bible says we are blessed with faithful Abraham. It says, so then they that are of Christ are of Abraham. Christ redeemed me from the curse of the law being made a curse for me, so that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through faith. Amen. Do you understand that? Glory to God. He didn't change. We entered into his covenant. That covenant that God made with Abraham over 4,000 years ago is still the basis of our relationship with God, because it's what opened the door for us to come into Christ. If God doesn't find Abraham to make a covenant with him, there's no door open for Jesus to get into the earth. But when God asked Abraham to take his son and take him up that mountain of Moriah and offer them him there as a sacrifice, Abraham put wood on his son's back and went up that mountain and offered the sacrifice, and it opened the door 2,000 years later for God to put wood on his son's back and him to walk up that very same mountain and pay for the sins of humanity. Amen. Hallelujah. Boy, God's good. Mm-mm-mm. We are innocent, and we have been innocent for over 2,000 years. Tell your neighbor, I'm innocent. Amen. I've been that way for over 2,000 years. Now, if you miss it, that doesn't change your innocency. Yeah, but I miss it. Well, God knew you were going to miss it, and he didn't. That didn't change your innocent standing. That didn't change your right standing with God. Standing is not conduct. You're not righteous because your conduct is always righteous. You're righteous because Jesus made you righteous. Am I helping you? See, because that's where the enemy sneaks in. Well, you did this and you failed and you missed the mark. Well, what do I do? Yeah, I sure did. Praise God. Amen. But if you're forgiven, are you?
Yes.
1 John 1:9 says, if you sin, if you're faithful, if you confess it, that he's faithful and just to forgive it.
Yes.
Know what he said? So if you've confessed it and forsaken it, it doesn't exist. You don't even have to answer that. Quit talking with that filth. Why are you holding a conversation with the devil? Well, you messed up and you did this. And I missed it. I know, oh dear God. Then they don't come to church. Then the pastor will call. Well, brother, sister, what's going on? Oh, pastor, you know, I missed it. Well, okay, well, come on back to church. You know, that's God's a forgiver. God loves you. Come on.
Yeah.
Amen.
But
people beat themselves up. Now again, that's not an excuse to just go do whatever you want to do. The Bible says the person that does that makes the blood of Jesus Christ a vain thing. He did die for us. Right? But if I miss it, my standing didn't change. Why? What was worked in me at the cross and in the resurrection of Jesus Christ is greater than the power of sin. The power that was greater brought me out of sin. A mistake cannot take me out of righteousness. Because I am in the greater power. I'm in the greater source. Amen. Hallelujah. Satan is defeated by the blood of the resurrection. Now, I got to get this to you. I'm almost done. Just bear with me. Hallelujah. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3. I've just got a couple more scriptures, but we got to see this because redemption's not complete if we don't talk about this. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. Now, notice it says that he went to paradise. Luke 23:43, when Jesus was on the cross, the thief that was there beside him, who at one time, the other gospel says, reviled him as well and made light of him, he finally looked at Jesus and figured out, I've been wrong. And he said, I want to be with you. You know, I believe on you. And Jesus said, this day you will be with me in paradise. Well, that should tell you how easy getting saved is. But here's the point. That man died under the old covenant. Now, paradise was not heaven. Paradise was Abraham's bosom. Paradise was the place of the righteous dead. Now understand that Jesus did not just go to the place of the righteous dead. Jesus went to the place of the unrighteous dead as well. He had to. Why? Had to pay the price. See, if he didn't go, you got to go. Because he had to perfectly pay the price. All right? Now, there are people that will take issue with that, and I don't have time to argue with them about it. It's in the Bible. You know, it's there. So however you need to deal with it. But the point is that after he defeated death, see, he could not release anybody from paradise had he not defeated death. Yeah. You understand? He had to release them because they were in the grip of death. Death was the enemy. Hebrews 2:14. It says that because the sons and daughters were flesh and blood, that Jesus also himself partook of the same, that through death he might defeat him that has the power of death, or destroy him that has the power of death, that is the devil. So he had to defeat death in order to release people from death. Everybody in here was spiritually dead. You were the walking dead when you came to Jesus. And the only way he could release you was having already defeated death. So he went and defeated death. He was not in Abraham's bosom for 3 days and three nights. He was paying the price for 3 days and three nights. And when the claims of justice were satisfied, see, God is completely just. There was a length of time that Jesus had to suffer to satisfy the claims of justice. When that was satisfied, amen, when that was satisfied, then he could release those that were in bondage and return. Do you understand that? Amen. God did not come down into the belly of the earth, that's enough, leave him alone. No, that it was a prescribed period of time that Jesus had to suffer. Now, amen. Hallelujah. The saints in paradise were waiting on Jesus. And here's why they were waiting on him. They were waiting on him to cash the promissory notes that they had been carrying for the last 1,500 years. Hebrews chapter 11 says that none of them received the promise, being Jesus, but they saw it afar off and embraced it and declared that it belonged to them. So for all of those years, Abraham and Sarah and David and Gideon and all these Old Testament heroes were carrying a promissory note around that had not been cashed. What was it? One day I will show up and I will deliver you and you'll go with me and forever we'll be together. Amen. And when he went into the belly of the earth, when he went into Abraham's bosom, they cashed that promissory note. See, once Jesus died and placed his blood on the mercy seat, he didn't forget those Old Testament saints. He went and preached to them so they could go into heaven. Now people say, did he preach so they could get saved? The word preach just means to proclaim. He proclaimed something to them. We don't know what it was. The Bible doesn't say. And if the Bible doesn't say, we can't say. He proclaimed something to them. He went and preached to them. He proclaimed to them. Well, what do you think it is? I believe he proclaimed, here I am. I am the resurrection and the life. Amen. And the Bible says in the book of Psalms that he led captivity captive. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So he preached to the captives, he cashed the promissory note they had lived under in the Old Testament and made them free to go to heaven. How? Through the blood of the resurrection. Amen. Now look at this last scripture in the book of John, chapter 20. Glory to God. I believe God. Verse 15. Jesus saith unto her, to Mary, woman, why do you weep? Who do you seek? She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, sir, if you have borne him hence, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. And Jesus said unto her, Mary, and she turned herself and said unto him, Rabboni, that is to say, Master. Jesus saith unto her, touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father and to my, and notice, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend to my Father and your Father and my God and your God. Well, she just about saw him come out of that tomb. He had not even ascended yet. I mean, this was just moments after the Holy Spirit had raised him from the dead. But notice what he said. I've not ascended to my Father and your Father. My God and your God. Something has changed. Now my Father's your Father. See, God wasn't always our Father. Why? Because we rejected Him. We chose a different Father. Jesus said people under sin that their father was the devil. Right? But when you got born again, your nature changed. And God became your Father. Amen. God is your God and God is your Father. Why? The blood of the resurrection. God is my Father. Say out loud, God is my Father.
God is my Father.
Hallelujah. When you continually keep this in your mind, there's blood between me and God. And it's not just any blood. It's covenant blood. It's blood that still speaks. Now see, these things are in the Bible. They're true. They're valid. Here's the issue, and I'm closing with this. Here's the issue. Most believers that you know never put them into practice. If a believer put this into practice on a consistent basis, there would be no days of defeat. There would be no days when sin lords over us. There would be no days when the world gets dominion over us. I didn't say you wouldn't have a bad day. I said that day wouldn't have dominion over you.
Amen.
Why? Because He said, sin shall not have dominion over you. Now here's what the church has taught. I say the church. Religion, not the church. Here's what religion has taught. Go on, guys. Here's what religion has taught. Y'all can pass out those elements. Here's what religion has taught. Let's make a quick hallelujah. Here's what religion has taught us. You can't help but sin. Well, where's that written? If I can't help it, then what power does the blood of Jesus have in that situation? When sin shall not have dominion over me. Do you understand that? I have a habit when I'm looking through my Bible, studying the Word. I will look at going through the book of Acts, the four Gospels. And I will look at how religion talks and never has an answer. When Paul was preaching in the book of Acts over and over again, religion would talk, but they never had an answer. And I always put in the side of my Bible, I'll write it somewhere under that verse, beside it, over it. Religion, all talk. Religion, all talk. Because I want to remind myself of that. I've had people in my life say, oh, you're religious. I said, no, I'm not religious, I'm saved. Because religious, by definition, means a return to bondage. I'm not in bondage, I've been made free. Don't buy into that. Well, I can't help this. This is just my nature. That's my family temper. Oh, that's the temper of the whatever. That runs in our family. All the men in our family are that way. Well, that was your former bloodline. But what happened when you got born again, according to 2 Peter, the DNA of God came into your life. That other bloodline doesn't count. It might be something that has to be overcome, but I have more than enough power and ability through the blood of Jesus Christ to overcome it. Amen. Do you understand that? And that's living in victory. So it's not, again, it's not enough to know there's blood there. It's one thing to know there's blood between me and God. There's another thing to act like there's blood between me and God. It's one thing to know my sins have been remitted. It's another thing to live like my sins are remitted. And there are some people in here, when we take these elements today, you're going to get cleansed of that. Because I'm telling you, there's still far too many people that have the remembrance of where they failed. And that keeps coming up as a reason why I can't move on. Well, you're going to move on today. Amen? Amen. Tell your neighbor, I'm going to move on today. Hallelujah. Let's partake of our cup today. The Bible says, we read it today, Jesus said this was the blood of the new covenant, shed for many for the remission of sins, the remitting, the moving away, the washing away, the wiping away, the nullifying, the moving out of the way of sin. When we celebrate this day, this resurrection day, we're not celebrating tulips, we're not celebrating lilies, we're not celebrating rabbits, eggs. We're celebrating the resurrection of the Son of God. And he not only arose, he said right here in John, he said, I've got to ascend to my God and your God, to my Father and your Father. Well, why did he have to sin? He had to sin with his blood, and he had to put it on the mercy seat. And I need you to see this before we take our elements. That mercy seat was a physical piece of furniture in the Old Testament tabernacle. And God said, I will meet you at the mercy seat. That'll be my seat. There's a reason it was called the mercy seat and not the lid of the ark. God said, where'd God meet him at? The mercy seat. See, things have not changed in heaven. That's still God's throne in heaven. The mercy seat. Jesus went and put his blood on the mercy seat. So the place where God resides is covered with the blood of Jesus. Because the mercy seat's not only the mercy seat, it's where people stand to be judged. And if you will come and you'll stand in that hallway, stand in that judgment place, and you'll plead the blood of Jesus and declare the blood of Jesus, amen, and receive the blood of Jesus, then you don't get judgment, you get mercy. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad? Yes. Father, we thank you today for this cup. We thank you for what it represents, the symbol that it is. Father, as we receive it today, we declare and decree that we are free from guilt, we are free from shame, and we are free from fear. And more importantly, we are brought into your family by the blood of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, partake of your cup today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Oh, we're grateful, Lord. We're thankful, Father. Thank you, Heavenly Father. Thank you, Lord. Father, now we come today, we come to the bread, and we thank you that according to your word, it is your body broken for us. Broken, Father, so that we could be whole. Broken so we could be complete. Now, Father, every fracture in families, every fracture in relationships, we just declare by partaking of this bread that we are free in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, partake of your bread today. Glory be to God. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Amen. Amen.